Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah. As-salatu as-salamu ala Rasulillah. Wa ala alihi wa ashabihi ajma'in. Amma ba'd. Chapter 22, the author says, Babu naskh al-ma'i min al-ma'. Aw, Babu naskh al-ma'u min al-ma'. Kitha ala al-hikaya. Wa wujub al-ghasli bil-tiqa' al-khitanain. Hadithu Abi Hurayrata radiyallahu anhu an-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam qala, Idha jalasa bayna shu'abihi al-arba'a. ثُمَّ جَاهَدَهَا فَقَدْ وَجَبَ الْغُسُلُ Chapter 22 says, regarding the hadith, الْمَاءُ مِنَ الْمَاءُ, that water comes from water, regarding this hadith and its ruling, is abrogated and cancelled. And that it's mandatory to make the ghusl when the two khitans touch and meet up. When the two khitans, the two skins, the two places of circumcision, when they meet, meaning the head or the tip of the man's penis inside of the woman's vagina. Once these two places of khitan, circumcision, the male being circumcised, the excess skin from his sexual organ, and small parts of the woman's sexual organ, the excess skin that covers and hides the head of the penis. And according to some of the ulama, as we've explained in detail, and Mufti Q&A channel, and in other hadiths as well, the ruling of female circumcision. And those ulama who hold the view that it's mandatory or not, or that whether it's mandatory or recommended or permissible or a good thing to do, they say a small piece of the clitoris and a small piece of the labia. So when these two parts meet up and touch directly and barely, then the ghusl is mandatory. And the previous ruling, al-ma'u min al-ma', water only comes from water, i.e. the water of the ghusl is mandatory because of the water from sexual ejaculation or discharge, the major discharge, the actual climax, having an orgasm for the male, and the mani, semen coming out of his body, or with regards to a woman and her reaching a climax, her reaching an orgasm, is that this is no longer the case. Rather, whenever there is raw and unprotected sexual intercourse between the man's penis and a woman's vagina, فَقَدْ وَجَبَ الْغُسْلُ, then the ghusl is now mandatory. The ghusl is now mandatory. Once more, to be extremely clear, the fiqh of this chapter is that at one point in time, it was obligatory to make the ghusl only if you reach sexual climax. At one point in time, that was the rule in the Sharia. Then another time came, and the Prophet ﷺ instructed his followers, or the Quran, or there was consensus, the ruling was cancelled. And that if you just have sex without reaching a climax, without ejaculation, you must make the ghusl with the condition that the two khitans meet. And the part of the body which is makhtun, the khitan part, the circumcised part, is what we have just explained in explicit detail. The chapter heading tells us, before we get into the hadith, and the chapter heading also excludes if a man and a woman had protected sexual intercourse. A man had vaginal sexual intercourse and he wore a condom, a male condom, or the woman had a female condom. What's important is that he was wearing a condom and he had sex for 20 seconds or a minute or however long and he did not reach climax. She did not reach climax. Then the ghusl is not necessarily mandatory because his khitan did not touch her khitan. As we say, as we've explained in detail with regards to the colloquial references, skins, when a man is about to have intercourse or he has intercourse with a woman or the opposite is about to get some skins, that's what's meant here. Khitan is the skin that is clipped, that's cut. So if it's not in direct contact, then there is no ghusl unless there is inzal, unless there is ejaculation. Clear bidin Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It doesn't mean that it's permissible for a person to have sex with someone who's not his wife with a condom or whatever the case may be. Khayrin inshallah. So that's the chapter heading. Hadith 199, the author says, Hadith Abi Huraira an Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam anhu qala, إذا جلس بين شعبها الأربع ثم جهدها فقد وجب الغسل. Hadith says, when a man sits between a woman's four parts and then moves and exerts himself, فقد وجب الغسل. The ghusl is now mandatory. The literal translation says, Hadith Abi Huraira رضي الله عنه عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أنه قال إذا جلس بين شعبها الأربع ثم جاهدها فقد وجب الغسل. Abu Huraira narrated, the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, whenever a man sits or lies or falls between a woman's four parts, ثم جاهدها, and then he begins to move vigorously, he begins to make jihad, he begins to struggle, فَقَدْ وَجَبَ الْغُسُلُ, he must make ghusl, he must wash. خَيْرًا inshallah. So the hadith is in clear tatabuk, clear relativity, connection between the chapter heading. The Prophet ﷺ is basically telling us in this hadith is that once you penetrate a woman, you must now make ghusl. Once you penetrate this woman, or a woman, once a man penetrates you, enters you, the ghusl is mandatory. Even if the sex is not pleasurable, if it doesn't last long, if there's no reaching of any climax, the ghusl is now wajib. It's now mandatory. That's what's meant by this hadith. ثُمَّ جَهَدَهَا, meaning a person moves, he inserts, so on and so forth, which is well known. That's the meaning of this hadith. So this hadith, as we're going to explain, An-Nawawi rahimahullah ta'ala, he says, or it says here in Sahih Muslim, and as we've explained before, the chapter headings in Sahih Muslim are not from Imam Muslim. And this is one of the distinguishing features between Sahih Bukhari and Sahih Muslim, or Sunan Abi Dawood, or Jami' At-Tirmidhi. The Abwab, the Tabweeb, the chapter headings are not from Imam Muslim. Imam Muslim only put Al-Kutub Al-Amma, عناوين الكتب العامة, كتاب الإيمان, كتاب الطهارة, كتاب الصلاة, كتاب كذا. That's it. As far as bab this, chapter that, chapter in this, no. Imam Muslim never did that. And the only thing he did was put the kitab, كتاب الإيمان. And on كتاب الإيمان, 100 hadith, for example, of all different types of chapter headings. Shafa'a, the virtue of Tawheed, the harm of shirk, no one enter Jannah unless they're a believer, intercession for the Prophet's uncle, as we explained in Kitab al-Iman. Those chapter headings don't come from Muslim. That wasn't the purpose of Imam Muslim's book. And it shows us the difference between Bukhari and Muslim. Bukhari, he wrote his book not only to be a compendium for hadith, and not only to be a mega store for siha, for authenticity, and the sunnah al-hadithiyya, the technicalities of hadith science, but he also wanted to make a superstore for fiqh. A one-stop for everything for fiqh. The athar, the istinbat, the issues of khilaf, and all the different things he placed in his book. And he masterfully crafted those chapter headings. Imam Muslim, he put all the hadiths in one kitab. And obviously, yasuq al-ahadith, he'll mention them with his chains of narrations and in specific places, in appropriate places, in groups. Four hadiths on one topic in a group, then another four in another group. And that is bimathabat bab. That's like a bab, but he didn't put it in there. The chapter headings in Sahih Muslim come from the shurah, come from the commentators and the explainers of the book, such as Qurtubi, and such as An-Nawawi. Everybody clear on this? So any chapter heading that you see in Sahih Muslim, know for sure it's not from Imam Muslim. So you can't say it's Imam Muslim's madhab or Imam Muslim's ikhtiyar, his choice. And that's the total opposite of Imam al-Bukhari. That is Imam al-Bukhari's madhab in the chapter. He's saying it's obligatory to do this. It's from the sunnah to do that. That's his madhab. That's what he chooses on the topic. Everybody clear on this? So therefore, Nawawi, he says, بَابُ نَسْخِ الْمَاءِ مِنَ الْمَاءِ وَبُجُوبِ الْغُسْلِ بِالْتِقَاءِ الْخِتَانِينَ. Nawawi says, chapter 22 in Sahih Muslim, that Al-ma'u min al-ma', water comes from water, is mansukh, that ruling is cancelled. Wa wujub al-ghusli bil-tiqa' al-khitanain, and that it's mandatory to make ghusl when the two khitans touch, when the two khitans meet. The exact same chapter heading is in Lu'lu Marjan. The compiler, Sheikh Muhammad Fuad Abdul Baqi, rahimahullah, he took all of those chapter headings, na'am, and he put them in his book. He made the tartib of certain books of hadith, whether it's Sahih Muslim, the actual tarqim, not the tartib, excuse me, the tarqim, the numbering system, the modern numbering system for one of the prints of Sahih Muslim. Also, he did service to Fath al-Bari and Sahih al-Bukhari as well. So this is one of the reasons why we find this carbon copy of the chapter headings in Al-Lu'lu wal-Marjan. Khair, inshallah. So this is what Nawi is saying here. Nawi, he says, Biltiqa al-Khitanain. He says, when the two khitans meet in touch. And we notice in the hadith Abi Huraira in Lu'lu wal-Marjan, and also reading Sahih Muslim here, that it doesn't state anything about a khitan in a hadith. It just says about sitting between her, quote-unquote, four parts, and then moving about. There are other narrations which mention about the إِذَا الْتَقَى الْخِتَانَ الْخِتَانَ أو إِذَا الْتَقَى الْخِتَانَانَ, when the two khitans meet and touch. So we see a chapter heading being placed on one hadith based off of other wordings of other hadith. خَيْرًا إِنْشَاءَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى. Another very important point of the hadith here is that it says here, between her four parts. It's a lot of different interpretations on with regards to that. What's important is that he's in her, inside of her. All right? Whether the ulama say her hands and her feet, whether they say four corners of her vaginal opening, and the different interpretations of four parts, four shu'aba, four sectors. And this benefits us that the ruling isn't specific to one sexual position. Because one may say between her parts, that's in a specific position. And other positions in which he's not between or it's not like that. The ruling is still the same. Khayran, inshallah. An-Nawawi rahimahullah ta'ala, after he gives the different interpretations of that statement, he says, وَمَعْنَى الْحَدِيثِ أَنَّ إِجَابُ الْغُسْلِ لَا يَتَوَقَفُ عَلَى نُزُولِ الْمَنِيِّ بل متى غابت الحشفة في الفرج وجب الغسل على الرجل والمرأة وهذا لا خلاف فيه اليوم وقد كان فيه خلاف لبعض الصحابة ومن بعدهم ثم انعقد الإجماع على ما ذكرنا وقد تقدم بيان هذا قال أصحابنا. He says here, this hadith means that he says the hadith means is that the ghusl is no longer dependent upon ejaculation or not. He says, whenever the tip of his penis, where the skin has been cut off, supposedly, say if a man wasn't circumcised, the ruling is the same as well. But obviously the Arabs, or many of them, they got circumcised because it was from the things that remained from their forefathers' teachings. Ismail, alayhi salatu wasalam, from Ibrahim, alayhi salatu wasalam. From the things that remained from the deen of Ibrahim, alayhi salatu wasalam. And people being born Muslim today, raised Muslim, accepting Islam, with regards to the surgery, getting a circumcision, many people ask about, etc. Khayran, inshallah. Moving forward, he says that's the only thing that's important, is that when that's missing inside of her, when his tip is inside of her, then the ghusl is mandatory, as we have explained. And he says, and there's no difference of opinion among anyone today. It's ijma'. But at a point in time, there was khilaf, but now there's ijma', as we have explained. Khayran, inshallah. And Nawawi says, and we've previously explained this as well in the book with regards to the previous chapter. Tayyip, moving forward. Nawawi, rahimahullah ta'ala, he then says, قَالَ أَصْحَابُنَا وَلَوْ غيبة أو غيب الحشفة في دبر امرأة أو دبر رجل أو فرج بهيمة أو دبرها وجب الغسل سواء كان المولج فيه حيا أو المولج فيه حيا أو ميتا صغيرا أو كبيرا وسواء كان ذلك عن قصد أم نسيان وسواء كان مختارا أو مكرها أو استدخلت المرأة ذكره وهو نائم وسواء انتشر الذكر أو أم لا وسواء كان مختونا أم أغلف فيجب الغسل في كل هذه الصور على الفاعل والمفعول به إلا إذا كان الفاعل أو المفعول به صبيا أو صبية فإنه لا يقال واجب عليه لأنه ليس مكلفا ولكن يقال صار جنبا فإن كان مميزا وجب على الولي أن يأمره بالغسل كما يأمره بالوضوء فإن صلى من غير غسل لم تصح صلاته ولم يغتسل حتى بلغ وجب عليه الغسل وإن اغتسل في الصبي أو في الصبا ثم بلغ لم يلزمه إعادة الغسل قال أصحابنا والاعتبار في الجماع بتغيب الحشفة من صحيح الذكر بالاتفاق فإذا غيب بكمالها تعلقت به جميع الأحكام ولا يشترط تغيب جميع الذكر بالاتفاق ولو غيب بعض الحشف لا يتعلق به شيء من أحكام الاتفاق إلا وجها شاذا ذكره بعض أصحابنا أن حكمه حكم جميعها وهذا الوجه غلط منكر متروك وأما إذا كان الذكر مقطوعا فإن بقي منه دون الحشفة لم يتعلق بشيء من الأحكام وإن كان الباقي قدر الحشفة إلى آخر كلامه طيب the author even says here or a Nawawi he then goes on to say it gives many different tafri'at many different subsidiary issues branches off from this base this foundation alright mentions many things that are amazing with regards to the detail of the Islamic legal system the detail of the Islamic legal system and of the Shafi'i madhab and the madhabs in general especially in a time in which the other parts of the world with nothing like this in detail of the legal system he discusses different scenarios some which are likely some of which are highly unlikely He gets down to the issue of a person being asleep, a woman taking her husband or a man's penis and sticking inside of her vagina without his choice, a tip of it, all of it, the rulings of zina, the difference between this and between fully inserting, and the list goes on when zina comes, so on and so forth, four people seeing the concept of homosexuality, sodomy, bestiality and all these different things which are prohibited but they are legal rulings and before someone is punished in the Islamic legal system or in court or so on and so forth these rulings must be established and this goes to show you the justice of Islam and that it's detail he did a crime he did an act that's mandatory that isn't mandatory he is punished for this but he's not punished for that how can that there's no dhulm there's no dhulm khairan inshallah so that's the summary of that before we stop, the author, he mentions here, he says, also from the rulings here, وَالثَّانِي طيب قَالَ وَلَوْ لَفَّ عَلَى ذَكْرِهِ خِرْقَةً وَأَوْلَجَهُ فِي فَرْجِ امْرَأَةٍ فِي ثَلَاثَةُ أَوْجِهٍ لِأَصْحَابِنَا الصحيح منها والمشهور أنه يجب عليهما الغسل والثاني لا يجب لأنه أولج في خرقة والثالث إن كانت الخرقة غليظة تمنع وصول اللذة والرطوبة لم يجب الغسل ولا وجب والله أعلم ولو was type the author said he mentioned different rulings here with regards to homosexuality, sodomy, anal sex and all those different things with regards to the ghusl being obligatory even though the acts are haram he then goes on to mention here and this is something we're going to mention because it's pertaining to a modern day issue and that is protected sex with a condom obviously, in the time of Noe, we don't necessarily know for sure, Allahu Alam, but we don't know with clear proof that they had a condom during his era, hundreds of years ago. The idea of contraceptives, the idea of some type of birth control, quote-unquote, taking a pill, taking this plant, eating this herb, the idea of causing a miscarriage, abortion, huh? Naam, the idea of a pregnancy test, they say that the ancient Egyptians, they had several ways of determining if a woman was pregnant or not through her urination. You study it and you read it, it's quite amazing. When you look at the modern pregnancy tests, take-home kits, you buy it in the pharmacy, and the ancient Egyptians were doing this only Allah knows best how many years before these modern hospitals and pharmacies. They had the idea of taking a urine sample and a test, having a pregnant woman urinate on certain plants or some of them even say yeast And if the yeast would rise and certain things will happen, it would prove that she's pregnant. Whereas only a pregnant woman has certain elements or things inside of her urinal tract or inside of her system that a non-pregnant woman doesn't. عَلَّمَ الْإِنسَانَ مَا لَمْ يَعْلَمْ. Allah taught man that which he didn't know. And it also shows that most of the modern technology today, if not all of it, medical science, is based off of something from the past. And the thing, this is the difference between now and then, many things from them, is that the people today just have the ability to do certain things technologically. But back then, the idea was there. The smarts, the brain power was nothing, is nothing new today. People were smarter then than they are now. They had more ingenuity, they had more creativity, they had more of a need, they had less resources. But it just didn't have the ability to engineer certain things yet. So the idea of determining a woman being pregnant for many reasons, marriage, divorce, separation, her husband going to war, slavery, concubinage, sleeping with a woman who's, she's a concubine, is she pregnant or not? Would a genealogy be mixed? It's important to know if a woman was pregnant then, just as it is now. So they had different ways of determining if a woman was pregnant. So what's important is the concept of a condom, whether it be a latex condom or whatever the case may be, a sheepskin, lambskin, whatever the case may be, rubber condom, etc. He mentions here the ruling of placing a khirqa, which is like a rag, a piece of cloth or cotton on one's private area, and then having vaginal intercourse or any other type of intercourse. Does the ghusl have to be made too, even if the person doesn't ejaculate? He mentions the difference of opinion among the Shafi'i jurists. And he says that some of them say that they still have to make the ghusl, even if there was protection, i.e. the khitan, the skin, did not touch the skin. And others, they say he doesn't have to, because it was a khirqa, cloth. And thirdly, if the khirqa is thick, and it prevents, listen carefully what Anoui says, al-ladha, enjoyment and pleasure, and also rutuba, moistness, the actual wetness of the intercourse, then they don't have to make the ghusl. And if that is very applicable to a condom, there is protection. Sexually transmitted infections and diseases, so on and so forth, are prevented because of the latex. As far as the pleasure, the leather, then obviously that's not necessarily the case. Many people still have intercourse and enjoy it with condoms and these different things. The point is that the hadith, the ruling in the hadith is about khitan. So one can say if the khitan has not been touched and a person did not ejaculate, then there is no ghusl. Wallahu a'lam. We've said this many times before, the importance of going back to the traditional books, the ancient books of hadith, of fiqh, and basing our modern fiqh off of them. There is no fiqh that floats from the air today. There's no fiqh whatsoever that just comes out of thin air today. It has to be based off of something, just like we said about the medicine. Modern pregnancy tests, a blood test, these things are old concepts, but it's just new technology today. Can a woman travel on an airplane by herself? There were no airplanes back then. There were no airports back then. Every place didn't have cameras and security guards, but the ulama of the past, they talked about safety. Sheikh Sam Taimi, he talks about safety. If a woman is safe in the road, she can travel without a mahram. So the concept is there, an airplane, security, TSA, passport, border, this and that, security, the concept is old. So many people, they go on different extremes of everything has to be modern, modernity, everything is new, the old books are of no use, they have no value. The ulama that are living today that have been trained in the traditional schools, they have no use, they have no value. That's extreme. And disrespecting those books, disrespecting those scholars is extreme. And then we have the other side of extremism, of people who are literally stuck in the past and have no idea of anything that's modern or no idea of any current day fiqh. And many rulings, many different scenarios are not in the Quran and Sunnah, and it's not upon us to follow them in 2017. Those, many of them, not all, but many of them were ijtihadat. The ulama of the past, of the 4th century, 5th century, 7th, 8th, 9th century, they tried their best. That was the technology that was prevalent during their times in Baghdad or in Sham. So this primitive, crude medicine or type of surgery that was in Baghdad in the 7th century, how can you come and say 2017, we have to follow the ijtihad of Nawawi? That doesn't make any sense to be stuck like that mentally. and that there are modern day issues, and there is technology, there is medical science, there are breakthroughs, and there is Western culture, and there is a huge melting pot in America and the UK, and there are different cultures, the Muslims mixed with the non-Muslims on a daily basis, nothing like how they mixed with them in the past. It was unknown where the Muslims in this large quantity lived as minorities under the security and the protection of the kuffar. It didn't work like that. So there are modern issues. There is a need for formlessness, quote unquote. There is a need to revamp and to reinvestigate many, many, many issues. And there are ilal and hikam. There are wisdoms and there are reasons behind Sharia being what it is in the rulings. But there is a balance. So you have to base the fiqh of today off of the fiqh of yesterday. That's the form. That's the asl. And then you branch off to the farah, the branch, and that's the formlessness. There is no one madhab that we stick to. There is no, where do you take it? There is none. You have to take the kalam of Nawi. You have to say what Qadha Iyad says. You have to, oh, you can't wipe over this kind of sock because this faqih didn't say that. La. You can't, that's unsuitable. And the same applies even up into the modern day ulama. Sheikh Abdulaziz bin Baz, he died many years ago. He was in the 20th century, not the 21st century. Sheikh Uthaymeen died many years ago, and the ulama who are alive today. But Sheikh bin Baz, he came in the 20th century. And if he based a fatwa off of something that was prevalent in 1975 or 1980 or 1995, and it does not exist anymore in 2017, or it's outdated, or it's different, or the information that was brought to him was inaccurate, or it was only pertaining to the Gulf of the Persian Gulf or the Gulf of Arabia, Saudi Arabia. You can't say that the people have to stick to it living in New York City. That's inaccurate. But at the same time, you don't disrespect him. At the same time, you don't say that the fiqh of Sheikh bin Baz or Nawi is totally useless and baseless, and it's the reason behind the Muslims being stuck and being behind. No. The best path is the middle path. Hopefully this is clear. And if it wasn't for the widespread extremism on both sides, we said, on both sides, there are zealots on both sides. There are people of extremism on both sides. There are many YouTube personalities on both sides. If you go on YouTube to this day, you can find all types of people selling their ideology of modernity or antiquity or whatever you want to call it. All right? It has to be a balance. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala surely knows best. Walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.